Hi, welcome. Great turnout, wonderful. I was just curious, I was standing in the back wondering how many of you have seen this film before. Wow. So this is going to be nostalgia evening. Maybe some of you, like me, first saw this film 50 years ago. Yeah? I saw this film in London when it came out, which was in March 1967. It was released in the US in December 66, but it was released in other territories in 67. As you probably know, it won Palme d'Or at Cannes in 67, so best picture, so pretty important. And it was, in many ways, the most successful film of Antonioni's career, both commercially and critically. Critics who had liked his previous films but found them quite demanding said, wow, he suddenly made an accessible film. Well, kind of more or less, apart from the weird ending. So that was, you know, a breakthrough. And then Zabriskie Point, which was his American film, disappointed audiences, and he never quite recovered his critical success after this. This is really the high point of his career. And what we're doing here is really celebrating this new edition, which was released last month by Criterion Collection. I had a small part in this. I wrote the essay for the booklet. But this edition is a two-disc edition, or one disc if you buy it on Blu-ray. Disc one contains the movie and a documentary about the movie called Blow Up of Blow Up. And disc two is a number of extras, and recent interview with Jane Birkin, one with Vanessa Redgrave, and a number of small featurettes made for this edition, interviews with people talking about the film in relation to photography and contemporary art. So it's, you know, it really is the best edition of the film available, not just for these extras, but for the 4K transfer that's been done, which we're going to see tonight on the Blu-ray. It's a pity it's not a bigger screen. It would look fantastic, blown up to a large size, but I think you'll get an idea of the quality of this transfer from this projection. I just want to say really very few things about it to introduce it. At the end, which will be around 8:30, if you would like to stay around, Kim Hendrickson, who produced this disc for Criterion, and I will be on stage to do a Q&A. So if you have questions about the making of the film or the weird ending or anything, we'd be very happy to interact with you for maybe 10, 15 minutes. So that'll be around 8:30 if we can get going on time. This film was the 10th feature that Antonioni made. He started making features in 1950. He already had a major critical reputation. But in 1966, he got a contract with Carlo Ponti, who was working for MGM, to make three pictures outside Italy. The first was Blow Up, which he shot in London. The second was Zabriskie Point, which he shot in California. And the third was The Passenger with Jack Nicholson and Maria Schneider, which was shot mainly in the Sahara, in southern Algeria and other parts, in Spain as well, Barcelona and London. So this was the kind of beginning of his international career. He had actually made a movie in England before, in 1954, an episode of a compilation film called I Vinti in English. So it wasn't his first film in English, but it was his first feature in English and the first one to be shot entirely in a location with English or British actors. That's him having an argument with Ponti about Zabriskie Point, which had gone way over budget. I couldn't find a picture of them looking happy together, but that's Ponti on the right. Actually, the idea for Blow Up was originally Carlo Ponti. Ponti wanted to make a film in London, a kind of semi-documentary about a photographer. And he had contacted David Bailey, sorry, and that's Bailey on the right there, sorry, second from the left. And he said, you know, will you make a film about you, a kind of dramatized documentary? And Bailey just said, no, I only want to be it and I can be a big star. I don't want to really make a milk film about my own life. And at that point, Antonioni came into the project because he was already developing a story about a photographer. So Antonioni and Ponti kind of got together and made this fictional story. John Cowan, who's the photographer on the left, gave his actual studio to Antonioni, and the film was shot in, all the studio sequences are actually done in Cowan's studio. Cowan moved out into a caravan, a trailer in the street, and got a lot of money for making it, best money ever made, for giving it to MGM for a couple of months, and then they shot there. And the character played by David Hemmings, who has no name in the film, he doesn't have a name, although in the script he's called Thomas. And the woman, played by Vanessa Redgrave, doesn't have a name either. Well, in the script, she's called Jane. The photographer character is based very much on Cowan, who had this very dynamic style of photographing. He wanted models to move around. There was a sequence in which he got on top of a model in this way and straddled her, just as David Hemmings does in this famous scene with Verushka. That's Jill Kennington, who actually plays one of the models in the film, in a shot by John Cowan, dancing rather improbably on a table in a London pub in a bikini. And then there's another one of her in a parachute. And in fact, that shot of her you see in the back of the shot here in Cowan's studio in the movie. And this kind of strange double life that the character leads, we first see him coming out of what in London is called the Doss House, so a place where homeless men sleep and get a meal. You don't know who he is, but he's disguised himself so he can take photographs of these people. And the actual photographs that we then see in his maquette, his mock-up book showing to his agent, are done by Don McCullen, who is a wonderful and very famous war photographer. And he was also a documentary photographer, and he did those shots of London homeless men. So this is kind of realistic. Sorry, so I can't turn this thing off. And then this kind of strange transformation, when he comes out of the Doss House, he jumps into his Rolls-Royce convertible, gets onto his car phone, which of course was a very rare luxury item in 1966, and makes various calls, and then goes and does this shoot. And then of course you have the central sequence in the film. I'm not going to give the plot away for those who haven't seen it, but where Antonioni really got interested in this project was in this idea of having his photographer stumble upon something that he photographed, and then only later did it sort of reveal a meaning to him that he hadn't understood at the time. And this is really the kind of central part of the film, both structurally, because it occupies the sort of central sequences of the film where he blows up these photographs in his studio. And he got this idea from a short story by Julio Cortázar, who's the Argentinian writer, who published this short story called La Babas del Diablo, The Dribble of the Devil, in 1959. Antonioni read it in an Italian translation, and he takes from it this central idea of a photographer photographing a couple of different ages. In the original story by Cortázar, it's actually a young boy and an older woman, and the photographer believes the older woman is trying to seduce the boy. He takes photos, the woman comes up very angrily and demands that he give her, sorry, that's Cortázar, that's Italo Calvino, I'll mention in a minute, and that's Antonioni with Tonino Guerra, who was the co-script writer on this film, and that's Edward Bond, who wrote the English dialogue, this wonderful, witty English dialogue, who was a sort of major radical playwright at the time. So in this Cortázar story, the woman demands the photographer give him the roll of film. He says no, but he's intrigued by her insistence. He goes back to his home. He blows up a print. He puts it on the wall, and he sees something there he hadn't noticed at the time. So that's in the kind of in the source story. What Antonioni did, encouraged by Calvino, because he invited Calvino to collaborate on the script. Calvino said, no, I'm too busy writing my own stuff, but here's a suggestion, just blow up the central part, because that's the most interesting bit, and make it all around that mystery of what's in the photograph. And that's exactly what Antonioni did. He enlarged that short piece of the Cortázar story to make really the most interesting part of the movie. And the movie ends with this enigmatic tennis game, which we can come on to and talk about if you like. But I think we should start the screening now, just to mention that Antonioni was a keen tennis player, and tennis features in a number of his films. He was actually a professional standard tennis player, and then he decided he'd make movies instead, which I think was probably a good choice. So enjoy the movie. See you at 8:30 for the discussion. Thank you. As I was saying at the beginning, Kim Hendrickson, who produced the Criterion edition, new edition, is here. Our idea is really just to take questions, maybe fill in anything that we might know about the film or be interested to talk about. We have one or two clips from the extras on the disc, which we may or may not show, depending on how it goes. But I think the main thing is to get some interaction with you. So, somebody like to start with a question or a comment? Or do you want to say something?
I was going to start with a question for you.
Oh, for me? Wow, okay.
David wrote the liner notes for this. I'm not sure he mentioned, but it's. I was just rereading it. Does it mark a shift for you from the four that came before this, L'Eclisse, L'Aventure, La Notte, and Red Desert, kind of ends one. Does this begin something new?
Yeah, I think so. I mean, I worked on other films by Antonioni, and I did the commentary on Red Desert for the Criterion disc. Actually, I did it for another disc, but you use it. Yeah, I mean, if you know Antonioni's early work, there's a lot of continuities. I think particularly the idea of an ending that leaves things open and goes somewhere else from the narrative. That's the ending of L'Aventura, really. It's certainly the ending of L'Eclisse. The last 5.5 minutes just play out on a montage of streets in Rome, and the two main characters disappear. And of course, at the end of that last shot, the David Hemmings character disappears from the shot. So this kind of, there is a kind of working against narrative, and the expectations of an audience to get a resolution of a story is certainly there in the earlier films. I guess what's new about this, it feels fresher, it's in English, it's got an English cast, it's got the Herbie Hancock music, it's all about London, it's got the London buzz. I really don't want to use that phrase, swinging London, because the Americans invented it. and I don't think the Brits ever really liked it very much. But you know, it's got that feel of 60s London, and it's one of the things that, of course, made the film successful. I'm not sure it's the most important part of the film, but it's certainly what made the film a hit with audiences.
I'm curious to see what you think about it. I mean, there's an interesting, there's a couple of interesting things that are gleaned from the extras. One is an interview with Jane Birkin, who was, you know, part of that weird menage a trois thing, where she said it was quite a scandal when it came out, but, you know, for her, they were just playing and it was really nothing. I don't know. I mean, I think it's something of the character that David Hemmings plays, but I don't think he really was ever very good. I mean, women were important roles, but it's not that he was ever...
Yeah, well, and women and Antonioni, we could go on a long time about this. I mean, there are some takes on the film. I think Peter Brunette, writing about it, says that, you know, there's a lot of sexism in the film, and in a lot of Antonioni film, there's, you know, women are objectified, commodified. And, it's not quite clear how much that's Antonioni enjoying this or how much he's, in some ways, getting a distance from it. He did say in interviews that he identified or like the David Hemmings character, you know, this kind of brat who says, bring the birds down and I can't stand those bloody
bitches. But that's mostly the time, bitches too. Wasn't that, I mean, there's the book at the time, there's a book of photographs called Birds
about women of London at the time, too.
I think that's very much part of the
time. But I think this kind of abrasive, dismissive treatment of these women and is in the character. I don't think that's Antonioni's own projection.
Jill Kennington... one of the models that's a model in life and a model in the film talks about how he wasn't very kind in the treatment of them on set while they were filming it.
Yeah. Yes, that's true. I mean, just a quick fill-in on that. I mean, I worked on Antonioni's relationship with actors, and he had a bad relationship with some of his actresses. He slapped Lucia Bosè on the set of, which was it, I think, Cronaca di un amore, to get her to cry. And... He shouted at women. He was quite hard with Sarah Miles on this. She got pretty upset. Vanessa Redgrave liked him because she spoke Italian, and she just said, you know, you direct me, I'll do whatever you want. And so he liked that. But of course, he was in love with Monica Vitti, and they were in a relationship, so she got a good treatment from him. But yeah, he could be pretty hard with women, and I think he was very hard with those models. He just placed them there and made them stand and... You know, in some ways, what David Hemmings does with the models is what he did with his actresses sometimes.
Yeah, I'm wondering what film did he make after that, David Hemmings?
David Hemmings made this weird film, which you've got an extract from, haven't you?
Yeah, it's called Something When I Laugh.
Only When I Laugh.
Only When I
laugh. Only when I laugh. It was a weird... Yeah, he did a number of things. And then, of course, he set up his own production company, didn't he, Hemdale? And he made a lot of money as a producer. And his last movie role, I think, was in Gladiator, wasn't it? Was it? No, what was he in? Was he in Gladiator? I mean, he died, I think, a few years ago. Put on a huge amount of weight. You know, he didn't look great. He looks much better in this than he did.
We have some early archival interviews, one from like 65 or 66. Yeah. I'm sorry, 67. So one from like 68, 69, and then one from 74, where he talks about how he didn't like the film at all, actually, when it came out.
Yeah, he didn't like it, that's right, and he didn't, yeah. Yeah.
Well, I mean, the most noticeable thing about this is that it's unresolved. So that was the kind of the point, like, you wanted to make this, like, to make up your own ending audience?
I think they were all high. I think he was high.
Did you say it's not resolved?
What?
Yeah.
Nothing was resolved.
Yeah. Yeah, audiences were puzzled and critics were puzzled, and Roger Ebert said famously that, you know, he thought there really wasn't a body, and, you know, just because you think you see a body doesn't mean there really is a murder. But I don't know about that. I mean, we see a body, and Antonioni decides to film a body. And then, of course, at the end, the body's disappeared and he doesn't kind of continue the quest. He goes off and joins that tennis game. I don't know where he's going with that. I mean, there are lots of ways you could deal with that. But just at the technical level, what he's doing is he's playing around with, you know, the image being there and not being there. So he runs after the ball, but there's no ball. And then when he throws the ball back, you hear the sound of rackets. So he's mixing in this, you know. So it's just confusing using, you know, soundtrack and using the actor miming, the kind of presence and absence of something. I think that's where it's going. I'm not sure whether it's particularly successful. I don't think it's a great ending, but he clearly, I think the point is he doesn't want the ending to be a resolution. He wants the audience to go somewhere else.
But isn't he, in a sense, questioning the nature of reality? Because he starts out with the mimes, right? He ends with the mimes. The mimes are playing with something that's not there, that is there.
I think I saw a
sort of resolution, if you will, but certainly a circular, it circles back to where it started.
I mean, David's article talks, a piece for the release talks about this too, but I think it's a film that's set in its political moment, and it's not that far after the Kennedy assassination and the Zapruder tapes and the photographs, which were enlarged and enlarged and enlarged. I think all of this is worked into this narrative of what one sees, what one can see, what one doesn't see. So that's certainly there.
But I don't think it's questioning the nature of reality, and I don't think it's a kind of philosophical movie in that sense. You know, is what we see real or not real? I don't really go with that. That wouldn't make it a particularly exciting movie for me. I think what really is interesting about it is the way it questions the relationship between images and the real. You know, this idea that you want to get closer and closer to something, so you blow it up and up, and the closer you get, the more it disappears, it kind of breaks up. And he does that by using this grainy photographic image, that the more you blow it up, the more abstract it becomes. So he's a photographer, and his relationship to the real is mediated through his camera and through images. And we, the audience, are watching a movie, which is a series of images. So I think what Antonio is doing is playing, is sort of challenging our relationship to that, you know, to the photographic image or the film image, rather than, I think, making a big claim about, you know, is what we experience real. After all, he does put a real body in the shot. So it's the photographer who kind of loses the grasp on the real. It's not the audience, I feel.
Yeah, I agree. And you know, the production of the film is quite interesting. He hired the famous documentary photographer Don McCullen to take those images that were taken in the park. You know, he's now a famous war photographer, maybe one of the most famous war photographers in the world, but he knew that he wanted a certain kind of filmmaker with a certain kind of film, and, you know, so there's that kind of authenticity that goes into the Tri-X, the blow-ups, all of that. You know, he was very, he gave all of, there were several photographers that this was based on. I mentioned Don McCollum, the social documentary photographer. The fashion photographer has his roots in three other important fashion photographers at the time, David Bailey, Terrence Donovan, and Brian Stuffy, all kind of famous and unique in that they kind of, in London at least, began a new style of fashion photography, which was in the streets and kind of had a documentary focus. But in preparing for the presentation or for writing the character of the photographer here, he questioned them all. And lots of questions were about, did they consider themselves artists? What, you know, did they enjoy their lives? You know, like lots of material questions about the value that they gained from their existence, which I think may speak to the broader question of who this character is and what he's searching for and what he decides in the end, whether he gives up or whatever that is. But I think that was very much an investigation that he was interested in exploring with these real life photographers. Mm-hmm.
Well, yeah, it's a good question. I think in Antonioni films, you don't really know because it doesn't give you a kind of inner account of the character. I think one of the things he does is play with the kind of opaque surface of people. You know, you read his face, you hear his words, but you don't get any kind of interior monologue, any narration by him. So it's deliberately kind of throwing us back onto, you know, who is this guy and what is he experiencing? But I think coming back to this idea about the real and the nature of the real, it's quite interesting that a Soviet critic, the Russian critic Yuri Lotman, who wrote in 1971 a book called Semiotics of Cinema, writes this brilliant essay at the end on blow-up, where he claims, and of course he's a good Marxist, so he would say this, you know, it's not that Antonioni questions the nature of the real, it's the character, because he's in this drug culture of capitalism and, you know, he gets kind of misled by drugs and pop music and therefore and alcohol. So he gets detached from the sense of the real. I don't think that's correct. But what it does, I think, open up is there's this space possibly between Antonioni's take on this and the character. The character is not a projection of Antonioni. So, you know, it does, I think, show the character trying to pursue a truth, you know, using the methods of a detective, in magnifying glass, ruler, you know, blowing up to get nearer and nearer. And what happens is the image just kind of evaporates in a way. The only one that's left in his studio after the other prints and negatives have been stolen is that one that's so blown up that he knows it's a body, but Patricia doesn't. She says it looks like one of Bill's paintings. And I think the kind of core of the film is really that idea of, you know, getting closer to something, but it kind of disintegrates from you. Such an interesting idea, really. Yeah.
Yeah. Just to follow up on a comment that was stated earlier, I was curious why you focus on, you characterize it as a really bizarre ending, which puzzled me because I see it not as an ending, but as a bookend. That to focus on the bizarre ending undermines or minimizes the consequence of the beginning of the film. Maybe. I don't think you can take it as a separate part, and you have to give a little bit more emphasis. Film is framed by these images of mimes and of the creation of reality. Mm. So we begin with this notion that we, as in the end, we're all, you know, they're all mimes, including the main character, inventing their reality. And that is introduced at the very beginning. And I was carrying that image through and asking myself those same questions, and although obviously there is that layer of historical significance and fascinating relationship to the times, many of those characters, and not all of them, are creating their own sense of reality, in part because of the times, in part because of the filmmaker, but I do see, you know, the fact that there's a body that we see in no way, I think, undermines the possibility that we are, all of us, the mimes, the characters, the viewers creating our reality. I mean, that's what was running through my head.
I mean, all I can say is that quite a few people have read the film in that way. I don't see it that way, and I've said I don't, but I mean, I think that's it's open to that kind of reading. That it's about the kind of, how you say, the kind of temporary nature of the real, or the elusive nature of the real. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I always wanted him just to drop the camera at the end. I wanted to know why the propeller.
Why does he buy a propeller? Well, that's David
Bailey. It relates to one of the photographers that was the basis for this, Terrence Donovan, I think.
Was it David Bailey?
It was one of the two, but yeah. I thought it was Terrence Donovan. But one of them had the rolls, and one of them had the propeller.
Yeah.
But it was an object that one of the real-life photographers had, and I think it was a reference, partly a reference to that, although I think it has another significance as
David Bailey said in an interview, how did I know I paid £8 for a propeller? So it was a kind of reference to that. Although other people, I think David Meller in the interview that he does for one of your extras says, you know, the propeller it's a kind of image of the modern, or at least the earlier modern, the early 20th century, you know, futurism, but it's already become an antique, a collectible object. So he's playing around with that idea that the modern becomes a collectible. And yeah, and in fact, the Vanessa Redgrave character says you can hang it on the ceiling like a fan. She wants to make it functional in some way. Yeah. Yeah.
Do you know something about the locations of the film?
Yeah. We know everything about the locations. The film nerds that I'm not, or that we're not, have kind of scouted every bit of London, and we know where everything is. There's a website that gives you every street, every...
I mean, Marion Park is the main park.
Marion Park is a small park in Charlton, South London, which is where that was. And I'm a Londoner. I'd never knew it until I saw the movie.
There is... I was there recently to do some interviews for the disc, and I didn't go to the park, but my partner went to the park, and... there is the park bench, and in the documentary, there's a new documentary that an Italian woman made, Valentina Agostini. So it's quite a nice documentary. It was done, 67 is actually the year that Blow Up premiered in Cannes. So this is the 50th anniversary at Cannes, and I believe they'll be screening it at the festival this year. But she made a documentary, it's called Blow Up of Blow Up, and Jill Kennington's in it, and Claire Peplow, who is married to Bertolucci, no. Yeah,
but was in a relationship with Antonioni.
And showed Antonio around London at the time. So lots of interesting people appear in this. But she starts by going to the park bench in Marion Park, and someone has scrawled in there, Blow Up. It's on the park bench still, and I think it says David Hemmings lived here, or David Hemmings something.
Yeah. But the only thing, I mean, I could go on about the London locations, but the interesting thing I think is that he's very responsive to the new architecture. So the opening scene with the mimes are going around in their Land Rover, that's the Economist building, which was built by the Smithsons in 61-62. So it's only 3 or 4 years old when that film is made. And then when Hemmings is driving with his Rolls, you go past these tower blocks in London Wall, which had just been put up. So, you know, like in L'Eclisse, or like in La Notte, he's, you know, with the Pirelli skyscraper at the beginning, he's really capturing, you know, the city in transformation. So you get that new London, and then you get the London of the Doss House. What you don't really get, apart from that very cheesy shot at the beginning, is tourist London. You know, there's that kind of the two black nuns and the guy walking up and down, and the guard, you know, it looks like something out of a postcard. But, you know, he leaves that behind and gets onto other locations. So he's capturing, you know, the vibrancy of the new London. But also, I think, capturing the fact that, you know, poor people are being driven out by the kind of wealth of the city. The city is becoming incredibly wealthy. It's a center of finance capital, and you get these homeless men. So there's also that element of social comment.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Long periods where David Hemmings' characters not saying anything, but you see all of this stuff going on inside of his head. Yeah. How was he directed?
I thought that was interesting. I mean, the Piers Hemming, is that his name?
Yeah.
Comments on that a little bit, because Antonio didn't speak English very well.
No, he gave directions in French, and they were translated on set to the actors who were speaking English. Yeah, that's right. I mean, Hemmings had a kind of interesting career. He was a singer. He was a very good singer. In fact, he sang in a Benjamin Britten opera, and I think Britten was in love with him. And then he got into a sort of movie career. Then he was playing.
He did a lot of theater. He says that, you know, this is his breakthrough role, 67. Everyone recognizes him. He becomes kind of famous. But he had done 26 productions before.
Movies, yeah. And the one thing that's in that interview, he was playing in this Dylan Thomas adaptation of Dylan Thomas's Adventures in the Skin Trade. In fact, somebody says in one of those discs that Antonioni calls his character Thomas because it's a reference to that. And he was earning £20 a week playing in this small theatre in Hampstead, which is where Antonioni saw him and said, I've got to have him for the part, because he was going to cast Terence Stamp. He said, no, I'll have this guy instead. And from £20 a week, he went to £7,000 a week, which was a pretty good step up for him. And he played
that's
in...
Reality.
Sorry?
That's reality.
That's reality.
How old was he in the movie?
I think he was 24. Yeah. 24.
He had been a child actor of sorts, theater, stage performances.
Yeah, and he did magic as well. So this thing he does with his coins, do you remember that? He's really doing that. He was a kind of, did magic tricks. This is all getting a bit trivia stuff, I think.
I'm curious about the restoration of the film. Was it very different originally?
No, it's not. I mean, we scan, you know, it's always about you have better technologies to make things look better. So we did have the original camera negative. The problem, Carlo De Palma, the cinematographer, is no longer alive, and Antonio is no longer alive. So, you know, we matched sources, original sources, and we think it looks really beautiful. We do know that he painted certain things. He painted, you know, the red really pops, and the grass in Marion Park, I think in some cases he painted
sprayed the grass,
greener so that it would pop, and you know, he painted streets black so that they, you know, appeared darker. It's not for me. I was saying to David earlier today that I find it very much a continuation with what he's doing in the color space of Red Desert as well when he's painting landscapes. I think he's interested in a certain effect that an intensity has.
Yeah. I must say, just seeing it on this screen, I hadn't seen this 4K transfer before, but it looks fabulous. And I mean, like some of you, I saw this film when it came out, and I don't remember it looking that good. So it's kind of been improved, really.
Yeah, but it wasn't, you know, a problematic film. It didn't have a lot of dirt and scratches and things like that. Yeah. So it's more just a matter of making sure the color space is right, and that can be very tricky, because you can do a lot with color. You can change it a lot.
But
how strange. What I think is, you asked about the restoration. I don't know about the technical side, but Antonioni is a kind of intensely spatial and visual director. And so much in this film is about the kind of tension created by putting characters in a certain space. So when you get Vanessa Redgrave and David Hemmings in the studio kind of walking around each other. Sorry?
So it's also about fragments.
Yeah, it's
the glass, the gray space.
Yeah. He's just so attentive to that. Or the space of the park, I think David Menner refers to it like a small theatre, a kind of open-air theatre. It's a small park, and it's framed by the trees. And, you know, so much in that sequence is to do with the sound, recording the sound live, so using microphones to get the wind. And I don't know if you noticed, but when he's in the studio doing the first of the kind of reconstruction of the scene with the enlargements on the wall, the camera goes in, and you just get the black and white shots, and a new movie is created, and you hear the sound of the park coming back. So that kind of extraordinary attention to sound quality, space, visual quality is really, I think, what's the most exciting thing about this film for me. In some ways, more than the narrative. Well, the narrative, after all, is created by those movements through space.
And I'm also interested in the kind of, as I said, sort of pre-production history, which, you had mentioned the painting by Ian Stevenson, the abstract painting that we see in the film. Ian Stevenson was a real person, and that character sort of is dressed like Ian Stevenson dressed in real life. But I think that there is a whole sort of pop art thing that's happening there outside of the frame as well. You see Peter Sedgley, the sphere on the wall. And so I think that there's very much an art movement that's happening at the time that is within the space of what's happening there too.
Mm. Yeah. He got a contract with MGM through Carlo Ponti to make three pictures outside Italy, and this was the first one. And Ponti wanted to make a London film, and Antonioni said, I could have located my story about a photographer elsewhere, could have done it in New York or Paris, but, you know, I went to London. Monica Vitti had been playing in a movie the year before, Modesty Blaze, opposite Terence Stamp. He'd visit her on the set and he'd said, you know, look, I haven't been back to London since the 50s. It's completely changed. It's an exciting place to be. So these kind of circumstances came together. Ponti wanting to work, give him a contract, him seeing Monica Vitti in London, getting the kind of London buzz, made him want to make a film there. And he didn't make another film in London, of course. That was the last film he made in London.
And the other two of the contract were Zabriskie Point and
Yeah,
Passenger,
Zabriskie Point,
right?
Which he made in 1970, and The Passenger in 74, was it? I can't remember. Anyway, yeah. Zabriskie Point did really bad with the critics. I think it's a really interesting film, but the Americans hated it on the whole. And that's another film with an ending that goes somewhere else.
He wanted to, didn't he?
Yeah, I think he wanted to. Yeah, I mean, Ponti said, "Look, here's, and I'm working for MGM. I'll give you a contract." And I think he wanted to. Yeah, he'd made this compilation film in 1954 in outside Italy, or two episodes, one in France and one in England. And I don't know. I mean, there were changes in his life. He was breaking up with Monica Vitti. There were kind of, you know, he'd been divorced a few years ago. I think he was ready to do something different.
I think it was also the opportunity for a budget that was probably much greater than he had ever worked with before.
Yeah. Sorry, why did...
No, I thought it was Ponti working to do it outside of the surprise.
Yeah, I mean, he did say that he couldn't have shot the romp scene with the two models in Italy at the time because censorship wouldn't have permitted it. So, I mean, he had a greater freedom to make certain scenes in London. And the drug taking probably would have been controversial in Italy at the time.
Yeah. Anyway, I'm glad you enjoyed it. It seemed to play very well.
Thank you.